Hey, good morning, everybody. I know I caught you off guard. Let me say that again. Good morning, everybody. Hey, the scriptures say this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. How many of you feel like rejoicing this morning? Okay, you can't sit down and rejoice, all right? You got to stand up because you got to clear your diaphragm and you got to, like, you can move your arms and stuff. So stand up, and I'm going to ask you again, how many of you feel like rejoicing this morning? Woo! All right. Did God not provide an awesomely beautiful day for our very first service back in three months? How amazing is that? So I am so excited that you're here this morning, and this is a happy day. I have missed you all so much, and so it is only appropriate that the very first song that we're singing lends into what we're talking about today. For those of you who are joining us on Facebook Live this morning, we are so glad that you're here. We're praying together as a band and as a team beforehand, and want you to know that even though you're not here physically, we know that you're here with us spiritually this morning. So I hope you're on your feet at home, because we're all on our feet here, and we're going to praise God because this is a happy day. God, we give you glory and honor and praise and give you all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
This morning, let's get those hands together. It's okay to clap.
Greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty joy of the faith. Life eternal. He's alive. Oh, happy day, oh, happy day. You wash my sins away. Oh, happy day, happy day. Will never be the same. Forever I am changed. Pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, sing, oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same.
Happy day,
my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Yes, forever I am changed. Forever I am changed.
Come on, let's lift up our joyous praise this morning on this happy day.
What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us. Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name.
This morning to worship your name, to worship a king who is so worthy.
Thank you, Jesus.
It is such a glorious day. It is such a joyous day, God. And it is all because of that powerful name, the name that is Jesus Christ, the name that is above all others, the one that conquers all things.
Yes, thank you, Lord Jesus.
We praise you this morning.
Death could not hold you. Veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. And you have no right. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name. trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, woe for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust him. Just to trust his cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge beneath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, woe for grace to trust him more.
Woe for grace to trust. Father God, we thank you this morning for that grace that you poured abundantly upon us. For that day when we once realized that even though we were a wretch and were lost, you came and you found us. We were that one lost sheep that had strayed away. But you came and you took us. You took us into your family. You forgave us. You gave us a new hope. You gave us, Lord, joy and peace and blessing after blessing. And here we are gathered today, Lord, together as your people to raise our voices in song and to praise you and glorify your holy and wonderful name. Thank you, Lord, that over the years when we've experienced dangers and toils and snares, all through it your grace was there and you brought us safely thus far. We glorify your name. We ask your blessing even upon this service and upon Pastor Doug, that in a few moments he will come and share the word of God. Lord, we're so excited to be together as the family of God. May your spirit work in our lives. Change us, Lord, that we may be more and more like you. We pray this in the name that is above every name, even the name of Jesus Christ, to whom be glory and dominion and power forever and ever. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. And if I could have the graduates who have been in touch with us over the past couple weeks, so high school and college graduates, come on up and gather kind of right where I'm standing in a socially distance appropriate blob. Yeah. So you guys will be off to the side there. And it sounds like the wind is trying to play the guitar. I could get used to this. I don't know about you guys. This is a pretty cool way to do church right here. So we wanted to take a few moments this morning to celebrate those who have graduated in this epic year of 2020. And even though you guys had like probably the greatest case of senioritis in the history of mankind, you basically didn't go to school for the past three months, right? Maybe at home. But you guys have had a tumultuous year, and yet you persevered. You have crossed the finish line, and we got some feedback there on one of the guitars. You guys did it, and we are so proud of you. We love you, and we want you to know that we here at Lighthouse think you guys are big deals. So how about a round of applause? And before we bring you up and introduce you, I just wanted to briefly share from a graduation speech of sorts that Jesus gave. And near the end of his ministry, he was preparing to go to the cross and then obviously rise again from the dead and accomplish everything that God had asked him to do on behalf of us. But that meant leaving his disciples and then transitioning them into this next phase. So in a sense, they were graduating. And he knows they're nervous, because who knows what's ahead? New challenges, new joys, of course, but they were going to have this new heightened sense of responsibility. And here's the advice that he gives them from John 15. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to me to be my disciples." And that advice, I hope, is the same advice that you guys can take to heart. And what I want to leave with you, that your life is about serving Jesus. Whoop. Hello? All right. Your life is about serving Jesus. Yeah, now we go. Here we go. We're going to start preaching. Bruce is getting excited. This is like a tent revival, right? But your life is about serving Jesus and bringing glory to him. Amen? And God wants you to bear fruit. He wants you to be successful. He wants you to do your jobs well. But as you do your jobs, you're also bringing the light of Christ into every situation that you have. And how do you do that? You obey Jesus' commands. And that's what he said. He says, if you love me, you will obey my commands. And as you love him and as you obey Jesus' commands and as you prove to be his disciples and you love one another, you bear fruit for him, and you bring the Father glory. And that's what it's all about. And you guys, in your educations and in your training, you have been equipped to uniquely bring glory to God. And our prayer is that as you go in Christ, as you remain attached to the vine, as you abide in him, Jesus will dwell in you, and you'll bear much fruit for the Father. That is our hope for you. And we, again, are so proud of you. We love you. And now we're going to give you gifts because that's a fun part of graduation. All right? So as I call your name, just feel free to walk up here and kind of stand in the center and actually see Evan and Kayla right there. They'll give you a little gift bag. And then We'll let everyone know where you graduated from and maybe some of your future plans. So first up, Caitlin Craig. So Caitlin graduated. I love this. Yep. Come on up here, Caitlin. Caitlin graduated from the Craig Academy Homeschool. Very prestigious. She is going to be attending Liberty University online, where she'll be majoring in accounting and minoring in evangelism. How cool is that? Caitlin, congratulations on your graduation. And if you want to just stand right over there as you come up. Okay, next up, I don't think Corey is with us today, but we just want to mention Corey Davison. He graduated from Crossroads, and he's interested in pursuing the field of psychology. Corey is son of Dave and Christy Mason. So congrats, Corey. Next up, we have Lainey Christine Dennison. She is another one of our homeschool, my sneaky helpers are going backstage. She graduated from homeschool. She enjoys working at Chick-fil-A. Thank you for serving humanity by working at Chick-fil-A. And that's one of her favorite things to do. She's very musical, plays piano and guitar, loves to use her voice, and she'll keep music in her life. She's always had a passion for dogs, and she hopes at some point to become a dog trainer. Is that true? Awesome. Wonderful. Congratulations on your graduation, Lainey. Next up, we have Ashley Herdening. All right, Ash. She graduated from Portage Central University. Yeah. Portage Central High School. She's a Mustang. She's super stoked, and we are also super stoked to announce that she'll be attending IWU, Indiana Wesleyan University, this fall. And not only attending IWU, which is a great school, but under the Kern program. And the Kern program is an incredible scholarship and program. I think you got school paid for, is that right? For the most part, a lot of it, which is amazing. And she's going to major in youth ministry and also Christian ministries on her way to a master's in practical theology. So, Ashley, congratulations. All right, now we get to our college graduates. First of all, we have Yetunde Giwa. Yetunde, I don't know which is brighter, the sun or your smile and dress. Yetunde has graduated from the KVCC nursing program. And thank you for going into the medical field and serving others with your gifts. So thank you, Yetunde. Next up, we have Madison Johnson. Come on up, Maddie. Maddie graduated from Cornerstone University with a BA in child and adolescent psychology. Can I call you for advice sometimes? Would that? Okay. And she plans on attending Western Michigan University this fall to work on obtaining her Master's of Social Work degree. So congratulations, Maddie. We're very proud of you. And did I hear you guys moved into your new house this weekend? That's a cool grad gift. Michael, good job, buddy. All right, next up, Elizabeth Odeyemi. Elizabeth, congratulations. You also graduated from KVCC with your nursing degree. Do you guys have jobs yet? Do you have positions? Where will you be working? You're moving to Iowa. Together, are you guys going to live? That is awesome that you get to go together. And Iowa just got a great gift. So thank you and congratulations. Next up, we have Monica Reyes. Monica graduated with her Bachelor degree of Arts with a major in communications and a minor in theater from WMU, fellow Bronco. Congratulations, Monica. And her future plans are to work in social media marketing for a theater company or other performing arts company. Very cool. Congratulations, Monica. And then finally, we have Tim Tufts. Tim, congratulations. He just graduated from Cornerstone University with a BA in psychology. He will be attending Grand Rapids Theological Seminary beginning this fall, pursuing a master's degree in Christian counseling. Congratulations. Excited to have you on the ministry team. Once again, we are just so proud of you all. We're sorry that your epic graduation plans got disrupted, but COVID-19 doesn't stop you from pursuing Christ. And we're just so excited to see the fruit that you will bear and know that we are praying for you. And with that, let me pray for you right now. Father, we thank you so much for these lives, for these special people that are your children who you have endowed with particular gifts and abilities and who you have given the opportunity to receive an education. And I thank you for the work that they have done in order to complete their studies. And I pray, Lord, that you would guide them and direct them in the next step of their journey so that they know how to best serve you and where they can bear the most fruit. And Father, we know that the key to their success is you. And I pray that they would know that deep in their heart, that regardless of what happens and where they go, God, that they would depend on you and they would seek your will and that they would rely on your power and that much fruit would be born through their efforts. We love you. We thank you for Jesus, and we thank you for the hope of glory that we have in him. Amen. Thank you, everyone.
Hey, let's give it up for these guys one more time. Great accomplishment. Fantastic. So excited for those of you who have graduated this year. And as Pastor Kyle said, I know that this year was kind of disappointing, and we had several people within our congregation and on our staff who wanted to make sure that we celebrated such a momentous and epic time in the lives of these different students. So, way to go, you guys. We're proud of you. And I am super thankful that, again, that you are here this morning. Are you ready to get into the Word of the Lord? Yeah? All right. So, am I feeding back because I'm close to the speakers? I'm good? Okay. All right. So I want to just one more time say thank you to those of you who are joining us on Facebook Live. Glad that you are with us here spiritually on an absolutely beautiful day. And I want you to know more than anything that this is the day the Lord has made. And more than anything, if you don't hear anything I have to say this morning, I want to make sure that you hear this. God loves you. In the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of national turmoil, in the midst of pain and anxiety and depression and all of these different things going on, maybe for some of you, the only thing you needed to hear this morning was God loves you. And so on the count of three, I just want you to say big and bold, God loves me, not Doug, but you, okay? On the count of three, God loves me, and I want you to say it loud. In fact, I want you to stand up with me. You've been sitting for a little while, got to clear out those diaphragms, do what my friend Dave Field just did, kind of shake it out a little bit, okay? On the count of three, we're going to say God loves me, and you got to say it with conviction, or I'm going to make you say it again. Ready? One, two, three. And everybody said, amen. All right. So November 24th. 1990. November 24th, 1990 is a day, an epic day in my life, because on that day, I married my best friend in the whole wide world. It was a beautiful day, a beautiful woman, a beautiful ceremony, okay, where she married an undeserving guy, okay? And it was an incredible day. Now, here's the thing. I was the youth pastor at a middle-sized Wesleyan church, which meant that I was not getting paid very much. And in that time, Sean's mom and stepdad had committed to generously pay for our wedding. But even with that in mind, there was no way that we could invite everybody from our church to go to the reception. Are you following me? Okay. It's just, there's no way we could pay for that unless we just simply served punch and goldfish crackers, okay? So we couldn't afford it. And so what our answer to that was this, that we invited everybody in the church to come to the wedding ceremony, And then we had certain people, friends and family and people like that, who we invited to the reception. Are you with me? Okay. So, the entire church was invited to the wedding ceremony and encouraged to bring gifts. And then, you know, family and friends were invited to the reception. Well, as you know, people are not dumb, okay? And so even at the end of the service, the pastor who married us said, hey, thank you all for being here. And those of you who were invited to the reception, you know where it is. We'll see you there. Oh, happy day. Goodbye. Okay? He walked off. Well, people aren't dumb, especially when it comes to food, parties, and celebrations. So the people who weren't invited to the reception just followed the people who were. And they came to the reception, which we didn't plan on. Okay? And so Sean and I, we went to get our pictures taken. And one of the things I wanted to do is I wanted to make sure we got our picture taken at the state capitol there in California. Really beautiful picture. Ended up being a beautiful picture. But it took longer than we planned on. And so my friends, being my friends, decided that we were taking too long to get our pictures done. And they were getting hungry. So they just started helping themselves to the food without us being there. Right? And so we finally get done with our pictures. We roll into the reception. People are clapping and cheering and stuff like that. And we are immediately met with a problem. The fact that we told our caterer this many people are coming to the reception and this many people showed up. Okay? And so we were met with the problem that we didn't have enough food at the reception for everybody. And of course, panic sets in. Because how many of you would agree that if you didn't have enough food at your reception or at your child's reception, that would be embarrassing? Raise your hand if you believe that to be true, okay? Many of you, and those of you who didn't raise your hand, either aren't parents, aren't married, or are liars, okay? So, I mean, that's deeply embarrassing, right? And so we got there, and I'll be honest with you, everything rolled. Our caterer was fantastic, was able to, get some other food, and everybody was able to eat. And we ended up having a wonderful, wonderful celebration. It was an incredible time. But I'll be honest with you, in that moment, before the celebration was able to happen, there was some serious panic and consternation going on. And so this morning, as we come together, like our wedding reception, you know, there was panic, but there was still that air of celebration. And today we have cause for celebration. I'm going to say that one more time because I need at least a couple of amens. Marilyn, I didn't even hear you. Okay, you got to be louder, all right? Work with me here. I'm a little farther away and it's outside. So today, in spite of what is going on around us, we have reason for celebration. Yeah. All right, much better, much better. Now, I know for some people that maybe I'm a little premature on the celebration side of things. But I would submit to you that this very day, we must celebrate together. Okay, this is the perfect time to celebrate. We've had our heads down for a long time. We've had to grind it out for a long time. And that has impacted our mental capacity and capabilities. It's impacted our relationships. It's created within us some just a downward look and trend. I remember when I was 8 years old, I was playing Little League Baseball. It was my first season playing Little League Baseball, and I played for Fletcher Hills Realty. We were green and white. Okay, I still remember those things. Playing for Fletcher Hills Realty. I'm 8 years old, and I remembered there was one particular game. I remember this well. We were just getting hammered. Okay, I mean, it was just ungodly. God left the field, and we were just getting demolished by Satan's forces. Okay, and so we're playing in this game. It's horrible. And so for some reason, one kid in our dugout starts crying. And as you well know, there's no crying in baseball. But this one kid, he starts to cry. And then another kid starts crying. Okay, remember, now I know some of you are going, well, that's lame. We're 8 years old, all right? And so one kid starts crying, a second kid starts crying, and then pretty soon there's guys, and I start crying. I just start crying. And one of the coaches, I still remember, Mr. Berger looks at me, and he goes, what are you crying about? And I was like, I don't know, right? And that's how I feel we are right now. That's kind of how I feel our society and culture is right now. It's like there are many of us who are gloomy, who are down, who are feeling anxious and oppressed in one way or another, and we don't know why. We don't know why we feel that way. We just are. And I would submit to you today that celebration is one of the things that we need to begin to recover. Because celebration contains the seeds of hope. Let me say that again. Celebration contains the seeds of hope. Celebration contains the seeds of hope. And so I want to help us to understand and see where celebration and hope intersect. And I want us to find two things out of this idea of celebration connecting with hope. Okay, two things. Everybody say two things. All right, we're going to find it in the book of John. We're going to find our seeds of hope through celebration in the book of John. And it's a story that some of us here are very familiar with. Now, early on in Jesus' ministry in John chapter 2, we read about some different things that happen and occur, okay? Jesus, at his baptism, is revealed as the Messiah. In that moment, okay, Jesus is looked at as a rabbi, as a prophet, or whatever, while you and I know that he was the Messiah. But in that moment, John the Baptist reveals to the Jews in that moment that Jesus is in fact more than a Messiah. He is more than a rabbi. He is the Christ. He's the Son of the living God. He is in fact the Messiah. Okay? So he's revealed in that moment. Then Jesus goes down and goes through and he begins the selection process of selecting his disciples. And so once he's selected the disciples, he goes on a little journey with them. It's not very far because they're kind of located in this area called Galilee. It's actually a larger area. It revolves around the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus and his disciples are based in Capernaum. And about, depending on which scholars you listen to, the city of Cana of Galilee, there are two different places where scholars and researchers believe it could be. It's either 3 miles away or 8 miles away, but obviously fairly close to where Jesus grew up and where they are now headquartered. And there's a wedding going on there. And so Jesus and his disciples are invited to this wedding in Cana of Galilee. So they make the journey, and it's 3 to 8 miles away, so they make the journey to Cana of Galilee for this particular wedding. And you got to know that it's a very big wedding because it wasn't just Jesus and his disciples, but Jesus' mom and his family were also not only invited, but they participated in the wedding. Now, here's what you and I need to understand about weddings in Jesus' time. It was not a one afternoon affair, okay? Y'all didn't get together at the synagogue and watch this ceremony that lasted anywhere from 20 minutes to 3 hours. And then I actually had a friend who had a wedding that went 3 hours, okay? I wasn't at that one. Anyway, okay. So you don't, you know, it's not like today where you go to a wedding ceremony. Typically that wedding ceremony is going to be, you know, 20 minutes to an hour. And then you get done and you go to a reception hall or building and you enjoy, you know, food and maybe some dancing and getting together. And then after about an hour, you go your separate way. That's not what it was like in Jesus' time. A wedding celebration in Jesus' time lasted for days. Days and upwards of 7 days this wedding celebration could last. And the host of the wedding celebration, the people who paid and footed the bill for the wedding celebration, was the groom's parents. How, dear Lord, I wish that was true today, okay, with three daughters. But the groom's family paid for the wedding celebration, and it would last upwards of 7 days. And their role was to make sure that everything was paid for and taken care of. And they didn't just invite family and friends and, you know, some of the people in their synagogue. They invited everybody. Everybody, which explains why Jesus and his disciples and Jesus' family would go like 3 to 8 miles walking to get to this wedding celebration, because you invited, you know, the people in your synagogue, you invited the people in your community, you invited people, you invited dignitaries to come, and you hoped that those dignitaries would show up at the wedding. And then you provided everything they needed, food and wine and all of that, For 7 days, you provided this, okay? And wine was an important part of the wedding celebration. It really was. It was a critical part of what happened during that time. So Jesus and his disciples, they make the trek to Cana of Galilee. And on the third day, it says in John chapter 2, on the third day, everybody say third day. Good band. Third day, okay? And it's not like the third day of the week. It would actually be, scholars believe, the third day of the wedding celebration. It says that they ran out of wine. Or they were about to run out of wine, okay? And which would be in a shame and honor culture, this would be huge. It would be huge, and it would be so shameful in their society, in their culture, and in their community, for this family to run out of wine. And so Jesus' mom is there. And it says, scholars tell us that the women would typically congregate around the food and the drinks and stuff like that, and the men would do what men do. And it says that Jesus, you know, Jesus was there, he's with his disciples, and his mom looks at Jesus and says, they're out of wine. They're out of wine. That's all she says. She doesn't say, can you do something about it? But as the son of a mom who would look at me and go, they're out of wine, I know exactly what she's saying. She's not just saying they're out of wine. She's saying they're out of wine. Go get some or do something about it. And so Jesus' mother Mary looks at Jesus and says, they're out of wine. And Jesus says, woman, why are you involving me in this? My hour has not come. Now, I know that some of us, we put the woman, you know, on that. That's not what Jesus was saying. The term there that Jesus was using that is translated woman is actually more of a familiar and gentle. It'd be like him saying either like, ma'am, or I believe he just said, mom, why are you involving me in this? My hour has not come. And in that time, scholars talk about how when anybody would talk about my hour has not come, Jesus, scholars believe, he wasn't so much talking about him as the revelation of the Messiah as much as they are that Jesus was talking about that this particular, whenever he started, whenever he did his first miracle, whenever he began, he was now on the road to Calvary. Whenever he started, whether it was a miracle or speaking, Jesus was now on the road to Calvary. My hour has not come for me to begin this journey. And I believe that Jesus is looking at it going, I came for this. I'm prepared for it. But I don't think I'm ready to start. You ever been in that place? You ever been in that where you've looked at it and you've gone, okay, I've worked on this. I've prepared for this. I know it's coming. I just don't want it to start. Now, that's not what the Bible says. But I kind of think that's what Jesus was saying. Because he knows once he does this miracle, his time begins to count down. Now, Rick George gives me a hard time because June 21st is the first day of summer. It's also the longest day of the year. June 22nd, time begins to shorten. And I hate that because I love these long days, right? Right? And I don't, like June 22nd is kind of a down day for me because we're beginning to move towards darker days. And I believe that's kind of how Jesus felt. That in this moment, he knew that once he does this miracle, He's going to do a bunch more stuff, but now the clock is counting down. He's moving toward the cross. And he says, woman, why are you involving me in this? My hour has not come. And you know what Mary said in that moment? Nothing. She didn't say anything to Jesus because she's a mom. She knows what to do. And she doesn't look at Jesus. She pretty much ignores Jesus and looks at the servants and says, whatever he tells you to do, just do it. You want to talk about putting pressure on somebody? Jesus couldn't just go, mom, I'm not dealing with this anymore. That's not, you could, Mary doesn't even pay. She just says, looks at the servants and says, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Jesus looks around and he sees six jars that were used for ritual purification. Okay, now you got to understand, these weren't jars like you and I would typically, we'd look at a jar and we would, you know, pour water from one jar into maybe a cup. These were stone containers that scripture tells us held 20 to 30 gallons of water. Stone containers that held 20 to 30 gallons of water. Now, I'm not going to spend any time and talk to you about, right now, talk about the ritual purification that the Jews would go through. Understanding that it was very simple for a person to become unclean. And when a person became unclean, they no longer could participate in the synagogue. Which for many of us here, if you were unclean and you couldn't come to church, you'd go, sweet, day off. Do whatever I want to do, okay? But for them, the synagogue was the hub of life for the community. If you were outside of the synagogue, you were outside the community. You were pretty much shunned. And so nobody wanted to be unclean because they wouldn't be part of the community. And so these ritual purification containers that would hold 20 to 30 gallons of water, they would basically dip water out of that. And they would use it to, you know, wash their hands, wash their head, whatever the case may be, to make themselves pure and clean, okay? So Jesus sees 6 of these stone containers that can hold 20 to 30 gallons of water. Now, I want you to think about this for a moment, okay? First of all, 20 to 30 gallons. You ready for this? I looked it up because I'm not too bright sometimes. 20 gallons of water, how much do you think that weighs? Just shout out. How much do you think that weighs? Nice. Somebody's heard this sermon before. Was that you, Mark Dudek? All right. 160 pounds. 166 pounds is 20 gallons. 30 gallons of water weighs 250 pounds. Now, stone, as you well know, is not light. Correct? It's not light. So when you combine the fact that these dudes were, you know, I don't know about you, but I always pictured these guys kind of going, all right, pick up this container, walk over, get some water, come back. No, 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 no. 20 to 30 gallons with the stone container, we're talking probably 250 to 300 pounds per container. And Jesus says, take those containers and fill them up with water. And the servants went, that's easy for you to say. Do you know how much those weigh? It's not what they did. Jesus said, pick up those containers, go and fill them up with water and bring them back. So they go, they get all of this water, 20 to 30 gallons times 6 is 100 and some to 200 and some gallons of water. Okay? They fill them up. And Jesus says, all right, go get the master of the ceremony to actually take him some of that water, have him taste it. And so the servant takes the water, takes it to the master of the banquet, and he tastes it, and he's shocked. He calls over the groom, okay? Because who is going to be embarrassed if there's no wine? Who? Shout it out. The groom. That's why he calls the groom over. And he says to the groom, what are you thinking? And the groom's like, what are you talking about? He says, what are you thinking? Almost everybody serves the best wine first. That way, after everybody's had their fill, and for some of those people, once they're tipsy, after 2 or 3 or 4 days, they're not going to recognize good wine from cheap wine. So you always serve the good wine first. But you have saved the good wine for last. Why have you done this? Why have you done this? And it says that the servants didn't say anything, but they knew where the wine came from. And this was the very first miracle that Jesus performed, the miracle at the wedding in Cana. It is a beautiful story that revolves around a celebration that becomes a time of trial because somebody came up short. And Jesus saved the day. Amen? All right. So two things. I told you I wanted two things. I wanted to share two things with you in this moment. Two very simple things that I want us to think about in this, okay? That we take from this historical event, not a story, not a myth, not a legend. This is historical fact. So two things that we take away from this historical fact. The first thing is this. When Jesus is present, all hope is not lost. When Jesus is present, all hope is not lost. When Jesus is present. So last year, we took a group of men to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. And it's one of my, as some of you know, before I came to Lighthouse, I was a speaker and I spoke at all kinds of men's retreats and churches and things like that. And one of my favorite retreats that we did when I wasn't working at Lighthouse was a men's retreat to Gettysburg. So last year in the fall, we did a men's retreat from Lighthouse to Gettysburg and went on the battlefield. And we learned lessons about what happened at Gettysburg and how we can correlate that to our lives spiritually. And one of my favorite stories on the battlefield revolves around a general, a Union general by the name of Winfield Scott Hancock. Winfield Scott Hancock. Now, Winfield Scott Hancock was known by his men as, their nickname for him was Hancock the Superb. What a cool nickname is that? Okay, he didn't give that name to himself. His men gave him that nickname, Hancock the Superb. He was recognized as being a man of valor, a man of honor. Okay, his men nicknamed him Hancock the Superb. He served with valor for 4 decades in the army. Okay, in fact, it was said that of Hancock that his mere presence would not only inspire his men, but his mere presence would change their mindset from one of defeat, where they thought they would lose the battle, to an attitude of, we're going to win this thing. Just by his presence, just by showing up, Hancock the Superb could inspire his men. In fact, there's a great quote by one of his soldiers, just a regular foot soldier in Hancock's group. And this soldier said this, I was made a hero by that man's presence. Woo! Think about that for a minute. I was made a hero by that man's presence. Not by what he did, not by what he said, but just by the fact that he showed up. I was made a hero. Hancock's presence changed the direction of the battle from going backwards to going forwards. His presence made all the difference. It gave his men hope. And my friends, we are in the same position, right? I start walking so far out here because I want to grab you and hold you and shake you and say the presence of Jesus gives us hope. The presence of Jesus gives us hope. When Jesus is present, all hope is not lost. And the same that was true for Hancock and his men is true for you and me today. When Jesus is involved, there is hope. When Jesus is involved and present, there is hope. And my friends, for some of you, that is what you need today. This is the message that you needed to hear because you need hope today. Because everything that's going on, medically, physically, emotionally, racially, relationally, all of that stuff, we look at it and where is our hope today? Because it sure ain't in the government. And it isn't in our economy. And it's not even found in a building. It's found in Jesus Christ and Christ alone. Because, my friends, when Jesus is present, all hope is not lost. And here's the second thing I'm wrapping up with, and it's this. Celebration brings hope. Celebration brings hope. Say that with me. Celebration brings hope, okay? A wedding is an amazing time to celebrate. When you think about it, it's a great reminder of our relationship with God. Two people at the altar in an intimate setting, sharing their vows of a lifelong commitment to each other and God before a community of family and friends. This is the very design of God. A loving commitment between God and you within the setting of this community. That's what we are here for. That's what we are doing here. That is why we come together as the body of Jesus Christ. It's why we celebrate the Passover. It's why we celebrate the resurrection. Because our hope is not found on this earth. It's found in Jesus Christ. And when we celebrate, we are reminded of the hope that we have. And my friends, I don't know about you, but now more than ever in our culture and in our community, we need hope. And our culture and our community needs hope. And they keep looking for it in different places when the only place it's going to be found is in Jesus Christ. And so as you find hope, you don't hold on to it. You don't hide it, put it in your pocket. You let that hope overflow onto a world that desperately needs it. And how do you do that? You celebrate. You celebrate. And I know that some of you are looking at it going, well, there's not much to celebrate today, Doug. Have you looked around? Yeah, I have looked around. And I know today, now more than ever, that I have to celebrate. Because my celebration of Jesus Christ and my celebration of the life that I have in Him is the only hope that I have. And it's the only way that I'm going to make through this time. And I know that it's the only way you'll make it through this time as well. So we are going to continue celebrating this morning together. We're going to go ahead and we're going to celebrate socially distanced, okay? We may air high five, we may air hug each other, okay? But we're celebrating this morning because I believe what I'm talking about. Do you believe this? I believe what I'm talking about. Do you believe this? All right, stand up with me. Father God, we believe this morning that when Jesus is present, all hope is not lost.
Amen.
And I pray for my brothers and sisters this morning who are hanging on by a thread. God, who today are experiencing anxiety and hurt or anger and bitterness, and they need to let it go. Because our hope is not found in a governmental system. It's not found in the financial sector. It's not found in anything but Jesus Christ alone. And when Jesus is present, all hope is not lost. And so today, God, we celebrate because us celebrating reminds us of the hope that we have. And I pray that our celebration would not be a Sunday morning thing, but it would be a Monday thing and a Tuesday thing and a Wednesday thing and a Thursday thing and a Friday thing and a Saturday thing. And that when we come together, we celebrate. And when we're in our cars by ourselves, we celebrate. To the glory of Jesus Christ, because this is what we believe. We love you, God, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our Savior, come on, let's lift this up. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again.
Give you something to celebrate about. Oh, it's Amanda's fault. That's what's going on. So, it's such a beautiful day, isn't it? Such a great thing to know that Christ is here, and because of that, we have hope. So glad you guys all made it out. Glad that some folks are watching online. Now, I have a few announcements for you, then we're going to close out. First, if you could remember to just sign in on the connection card, whether you're online with us or here, get on the app. Let us know you're here. Let us know what touched you in the service and what God said to you. Let us know how we can pray with you and for you. Connection card is a great way for us to stay in community. Okay, and it's very important over the next few weeks that you guys are diligent at checking the app, the website, or the Facebook page. We are planning on doing this again next Sunday, 10 a.m. Okay, that is our plan. Things change. Okay, we're watching weather. So like Friday or Saturday afternoon, go check our website. Make sure we didn't change the time. Make sure we didn't move it to online only, because we're not ready to go back in the building. So if there's weather, the rain, we're going to be just moving to online. So it's important you guys watch and be on top of what's going on. You're also going to find all the other things that are still going on. We do have a blood drive coming at the end of the month. We have lots of things that are happening, and just everything's changing quickly. Be in tune to what's going on. It's going to be a great thing. You can also go there. You can do your connection card. You can do your online offering. Okay, if you're here with us in person, you were asking me about the offering. The black boxes are in the back. You can drop your offering in there. And just, it's great to be in community, isn't it? I'm
me look at my list to make sure I got everything. Oh, so some of you probably came and the screens are a little hard with the sun to see. Okay, if you're on the app, in the email, on the Facebook page, you're going to find the PDF for the songs we'll be singing in the words. So you can print them off and bring them with you. You can also do digital slides. All the links are there for that. So please spend time on our social media and our website and our app to be up to tune with everything going on. It's a great day. Let me pray us out, and then we're just going to celebrate God throughout the week. Let's pray. Father, we praise you today. We thank you for the sun. We thank you for the cool breezes. We thank you for your love. God, we thank you for the fact that you stepped out on that day and you turned the water to wine, knowing what it was starting. But God, it is through your actions, your love, your sacrifice, that we have hope through each and everything that brings us stress and anxiety and fear in our lives. Lord, we lift those things to you, and we celebrate who you are. You are God, our Father, the only risen one. In your name we pray. Amen. Go, be in community, church.
Amen.
Be in community, hang around, talk to each other, but please, we encourage you guys, maintain social distancing. Be considerate and loving of your neighbor during this season.